Hi everyone, thanks for coming. And thank you, Orange, again for hosting and for that great informational session about health and mobile payments in Africa. I want to talk to you guys a little bit about the tour of tech that we're leading in September. And before I get started in that, I'll tell you a little bit about myself and my story and Ingressive story. So I am executive director of Ingressive. Ingressive is a company that connects the new generation of African innovators with the global resources to help them scale. And the way that this got started, or the reason that I got started, I'm Nigerian. And from growing up in that community, as well as doing a lot of research in emerging markets, studying the way Western nonprofits, different organizations influence developing nations, I kept seeing these brilliant innovators, these brilliant young people, these creators building things and getting their community members together and you know, pushing for movements. And even in Lagos, like this outfit that I'm wearing right now is created by my tailor that I have there, and he is Tolu's. Is anyways, I won't get into details. He's really cool, as you can see. But yeah, from working with all of these entrepreneurs in Madagascar and Nigeria and in the Caribbean and South America, and finding time and time again these people with all of this talent and all of this vision and all of these immediate problems that entrepreneurship and business can solve, not having access to capital and not having the technical support they need to scale. And like for an example, like Tolu, the designer who made this and who is creating products in Nigeria right now for political campaigns and for high fashion models and you know, great people across the sub-Saharan, he can't get a loan for $1,000 to outsource his product to China. And it's like, well, this person who has this great business and this great design can't get the resources that they need. Like, what is this inefficiency? So to pull back a little bit, to provide a little bit of details on that, so the average interest rate in sub-Saharan Africa is 25%. And that means if you're a young entrepreneur and you want to start a business, you have to pay 25% interest rate on any loan that you're taking out. And that's just kind of unrealistic for a lot of small businesses. And the other part of it is so it's the lack of access to capital, and in sub-Saharan Africa, there aren't as many examples. So it's like, okay, well, they can't get it from the bank, so why can't they get it from individual investors or institutional investors? Well, it's in Africa, there haven't been as many success stories as we've seen in the U.S. Here we have the Facebooks, the Ubers, the you know, Googles, and it's like, oh, you have no revenue, and you're a year and a half into building, but you know, it's a $5 million, $10 million, $50 million valuation. Sure, okay, yeah, I agree with that. And in Africa, people are like, no, I don't believe in that yet. And so it's a lack of willing investors in addition to the high interest rates on loans. And so that's one component of it. And on the other side of it is a lack of technical support. So most of the entrepreneurs that I saw and most of the people that I was working with who are trying to scale their business are the first in that industry, are pioneering their respective industries, especially in the tech space. And with that, so even if you do get access to capital, it's like, well, how many salespeople do we hire and when do we put the product to market? And those sorts of things where you need to have that entrepreneurial infrastructure in order to really understand how to build. And so with that, we created Ingressive. And the tour of tech, the purpose of the tour of tech is to connect these global investors, so the people in the U.S. who understand the opportunities in Africa, understand 6 of the 10 fastest growing economies in the world are in the sub-Saharan right now. You know, the fastest growing consumer class, the youngest population, there's just 650 million mobile users, there's just incredible opportunity. And so the people who understand that, connecting them with the sub-Saharan based businesses. Dun, dun, dun. So a little bit about Ingressive and a little bit about Tastemakers Africa, who's our partner in the tour of tech that we're leading in the fall. And Tastemakers Africa is a luxury local boutique travel company. So they connect any sort of world traveler with the local sub-Saharan, the local African experience. And we are aggressive. And the event. So the Tour of Tech itself, happening September 20th through the 27th. We're starting in Nairobi and then heading over to Lagos. And which are two of the if you know sub-Saharan Africa, if you don't know actually, Nairobi is the fastest growing tech hub in any emerging market right now. And Nigeria, wealthiest black nation, you know, 173 million people, like a lot of development, crazy stuff happening in there. Tech, also a big tech ecosystem. So we're pinpointing the two fastest growing economies relative to the tech space. And so what the event is, yes. 2 days in Nairobi, nice leisure safari, in addition to meeting with tech executives, ministry officials, basically anyone in the local economy that you need to meet with in order to either understand what it means to invest in the local market or get started on partnering with the right people so you can invest in the market. And then after that, heading over to Lagos. So yes, the African opportunity, lots of African opportunities. And a few facts that I touched on. And heading over to Lagos and attending She Leads Africa and Demo Africa, which are the top two startup showcases in sub-Saharan, period. So the purpose of this event, the purpose of what we're doing, is to get investors and also successful tech executives, so people who know how to build operations, people who know how to build businesses, get them over to Lagos, get them over to Nairobi to meet with entrepreneurs and then leave with investment opportunities. And so this is some of the stuff that we'll be exploring over the course of the week. Attending Demo Africa, over 800 African startups apply, top 50 are selected, and they present in the AI, robotics, and software technology sectors. She Leads Africa, women entrepreneurs from across the sub-Saharan. And also a focus on renewable energy. So we'll have a private event for renewable energy-focused investors for some of the biggest players across the sub-Saharan on the Thursday of the Tour of Tech. And so these are some of our partners. So not only will we be meeting with hundreds of entrepreneurs over the course of the week and meeting with ministry officials, policymakers, investors who can teach you how to and why to invest in the sub-Saharan, but we have partnered with some of the biggest entrepreneurial hubs in Nairobi or in Nigeria. CC Hub, IDEA, 440, Generation Enterprise, which is basically like M&A activity for the slums, which is kind of cool if you think about it. And also, we'll be attending an investor summit that Wednesday where Lagos Angel Network, African Business Angel Network, and Ghanaian Angel Network, VC for Africa is hosting it. So a lot of meeting with people who are active in the market, getting to understand. And the cool part about this, we'll be staying on a private beach, a private island, about 30 minutes off the coast of Lagos. And if you're interested in coming along on our Tour of Tech, please contact me, maya@ingressive.co, the same email address you used to register for this event. Thank you. Before we get started with the actual questions, I'd like to do a little introduction to all of the fine, smart, accomplished panelists we have here today. And we will start with Matt. So if you guys would like to give a little introduction as far as your space, your expertise, and maybe a little anecdote about Africa and wherever you're working, that kind of cool stuff.
All right, thanks. my name is Matt Flannery. I'm a little hoarse, sorry, guys.
Do you need water?
Let's try to clear that. Yeah, water would be great. So a little bit about myself. About 10 years ago, I was a software developer at TiVo, right out of Stanford University, my first tech job in Silicon Valley. But I took some time off because I was a little restless with my job, and I wasn't sure I could see myself programming, television programs for the rest of my life. And I went on a long trip across sub-Saharan Africa, mostly East Africa, and ended up volunteering for a microfinance institution in Uganda, interviewing small business entrepreneurs and essentially making a documentary about their work. And I'd heard a lot about microfinance and Muhammad Yunus and was really inspired by that. And I ended up just really having a great time, an inspiring time. And it was really my introduction to entrepreneurship through the eyes of these small business entrepreneurs in rural Uganda. And so I had the idea to connect their work with the internet. And so in about 2005, I started Kiva.org. It's a nonprofit that's a person-to-person lending website where people lend, you know, small amounts of money, not donate, to small business people, first in Uganda, then in Kenya, then in Tanzania, and then all across sub-Saharan Africa, and then eventually in 60 countries around the world. And so I ran Kiva from, you know, one country to lending almost $1 billion to people all over the world, including right here in San Francisco. And I recently got inspired, like a couple years ago, I got really interested in the rise in mobile technology and mobile wallets. And I was visiting my borrowers that I was working with and noticing they would friend me on Facebook after I met them, and they would text me, and I could communicate with them freely across the ocean. And so I got really interested in trying to lend money to them via mobile phone. And I started doing that at Kiva in a couple of years ago, and it worked out really, really well. And so earlier this year, I was excited to do a new startup, and you know, I was getting tired of being the CEO of a large nonprofit. So I branched out on my own, and I started a new company, lending to people on their phones in Kenya, and then we're quickly moving to Tanzania and Uganda later this year. And so right now, I run the seed stage startup called Branch, and we are a mobile banking startup in Kenya. Basically, it's an Android app. People download our app on phones, and we get a lot of data about them. We ask for their permissions to get their contact list, their call history, their payment history via M-Pesa. And it's really amazing what's happening. We get so much data, and we can tell so much about them. And we wrote a machine learning program that learns more about our borrowers and what makes a good borrower out there. And we're lending like $10, $20, $30 at a time to Kenyans right now. We just started like 4 months ago, so I'm really in the opening stage of this. But you know, a couple things I've been amazed at is the demand for this kind of product. There's rampant demand all across East Africa for quick, short-term loans, fast money on your phones. Because as you're mentioning, people don't have ready access to liquidity. They don't have ready access to credit. Banks are really inefficient. They take a long time to process loans. And so these are short-term, uncollateralized, unsecured loans that we're giving to people. And if they pay back a short-term loan, they can get a longer-term loan. So the first loan we give to people is a one-month loan. It's about $10. And if you keep paying back, you can get a $1,000 loan. That's 12 months. And so we're seeing these people prove themselves, and we've made about 10,000 loans in the last 4 months, just starting out here from San Francisco, and we have a customer service staff in Kenya. And we're working at a startup incubator out there. So I think it's a great time to start a high-tech startup in Africa. People are adopting Facebook, they're adopting Android, they're adopting mobile money at record pace, and the people are modernizing, urbanizing, and coming into the middle class, and there's a big unmet consumer need for all sorts of startups like the one that I started. So just seeing incredible growth, and I'm pretty tired because of it. But that's sort of where my head is right now, and if you guys have any questions or want to talk about it, feel free to ask me.
Okay, I'll go next. My name is Wyvon Hutchinson. I'm a former international human rights and labor rights lawyer who also worked in the field of international development in several conflict and post-conflict countries around the world. I've just founded and now run a consultancy focused on labor policy, employment policy, and diversity for tech companies. That's pretty much what I do here. I'm also affiliated with the Harvard Institute for Global Law and Policy, where I study global economic governance and international labor law.
I guess I should be next. Okay. My name is Bolaji Olutade. I'm actually a technologist. I moved to the Bay Area several years ago from Atlanta. I'm originally from Nigeria. I moved because, you know, this is where technology happens, and I have, you know, background in electrical and computer engineering. A few years back, I founded a nonprofit called the African Network, which the idea was we wanted to foster entrepreneurship, you know, among people of African descent, because when we were in the Bay Area, we didn't see a lot of us getting to here at that point. So when we started the organization, we tried to get everybody together. We started organizing conferences and networking events. Matt actually spoke at a conference a few years back. And so more recently, what we've been doing now is we kind of change focus a little bit. You know, we've had conferences in the Bay Area, we've had in Africa, we have in Ghana and Sierra Leone. But now the focus right now is we're helping out small and medium businesses, you know, in Africa to kind of get exposure to what's going on in the Bay Area or to what's going on in the West. And what I mean by the exposure is because these guys are at the point where they started their company, but now they need to look into what do we do to kind of scale, you know, because that's what investors are talking about, you know, if they're looking for money. So now what we're doing is we're trying to kind of take these guys and bring them to the Bay Area, get them exposure to, you know, businesses here, be it Google, Uber. We can actually talk to them on how do you scale your business from where you are right now. So that's been the focus, and I will talk a little bit more about that as we go on.
My name is Larry Hercules, and I'm originally from the Caribbean. Migrated here maybe 15 years ago. Spent 10 years in the Caribbean designing and optimizing from 1G network to 3G networks. Came here, designed 3G networks for the carriers on the East Coast. Then built the first 4G network in the US. Did a bunch of stuff around transit and wireless. Came to the Bay 5 years ago. Started my own startup. Around mobile network quality. And now I work for the second largest carrier in the US, where I lead a group looking at big data around a range of industries, doing data science, analytics, and data in general, including structured data, unstructured data, streaming data, real-time data, anything to do with data. So now my world is filled with data, and there's real opportunities now with, one, the connectivity that is available, and two, the use of design thinking to use technology as a vehicle to scale entrepreneurs. So so that's me in a nutshell.
My name is Obina Ukwani. Finished up at MIT not too long ago. I'm a Nigerian-American, born and raised in Washington, D.C. I've been here in the Bay Area for 5 weeks now. my background is in education and entrepreneurship. While I was still a student, I founded Nigeria's premier program that was targeted at high school students, which was designed to teach them the principles of engineering and creative problem solving. It was called Exposure Robotics. Over the course of 3 years, I partnered with companies like Shell and some of the larger banks to provide education to over 113 kids in the format of a 5-week intense residential boot camp. I flew down MIT students and international team every year down to the country to live with and mentor these students. Had a lot of amazing outcomes, which I can talk about as we continue our discussion. And most recently, one of my students, a young girl, is matriculating at Bryn Mawr on full scholarship in August, and a lot of other amazing things. Currently, I'm working to set up a center of excellence for innovation in Southeast Nigeria, and I actually leave at the end of the month, so yeah, trying to make the most of my time here.
Yeah. I think with that, we will get started. First question, Obi, since you were sitting on the end and just happened to be talking about education, let's start in that space. I want to paint a picture for you guys as far as the horizon of and the landscape for African-based innovators. So Obi specifically have a question for you. Coming from the education space, can you share your experience cultivating innovators on the continent? And for the group at large, can you tell me about what happens when you give smart people the tools they need to succeed?
Yeah, I think first of all, it's important to recognize that as Jeremy Jay, the founder of Andela, you guys might know about him, he says that intelligence and talent is uniformly distributed across the world, right? But riches and innovation and amazing things aren't. And that's because of a variety of different factors. And for me, I think the core of it is education as far as Africa's problem is concerned. And so my core belief is that first and foremost, if you want to see more innovators coming out of the continent, educate more people, give them better education. I think that's one of the most fundamental issues the continent has. And I can speak specifically about Nigeria, where our education system teaches kids a bunch of theory, sometimes the right theory, in many cases the wrong theory, but then gives them almost no practical foundation. So you have computer science graduates graduating having never programmed a computer. So my work was targeted at younger people, folks that haven't gotten to university yet, because I believe that if you want people to grow into amazing people like Elon Musk and Bill Gates, folks need to, you know, they need to be exposed to technology and things like that at a very young age. I've had a number of experiences where a smart Nigerian kid, I've given someone a book, put someone through a class, and you come back 3-4 years later, and that person has started a company, right? I mean, folks in Nigeria and Africa, they're always looking for a way to better themselves, just like every human being is, right? They just need to be exposed to the knowledge that will allow them to, I guess, capitalize on that innate drive that we all have. And so, in my experience, education is at the core of that, yeah, making an innovator.
Yeah, I'll also like to add to that. I'm from Trinidad and Tobago in the Caribbean, and we are oil producing country as well. But our government in the 80s made a commitment to make education free up to PhD level. And then maybe 5 years ago, every child graduating from elementary school gets a laptop. And whether or not they use the laptop for whatever it is, they're already kind of building a relationship between themselves and this piece of technology. And so on Sunday, I was able to have conversation with my niece, who's 11, about Ruby on Rails and some stuff she wants to build, right? And this is normal. My mom called me 2 days ago talking about Alphabet on Google, which is normal. She's 76, right? And so these things are normal because the resources are there, and not necessarily because of talent. And so even when I came to the US, I never had the identity issues that exist sometimes in societies. And so there was never a concept of lack because of who I am or where I was from. And that perspective allowed me to basically design first 4G network in the US. And to me, it was still nothing compared to what my parents achieved and what they had. So I think, go back to what he was saying, is that a lot of time mentorship is needed. I had conversation with my other niece today. She's 23 on a fourth company, building an incubator. And to her, she's not overachieving. It's normal. And so raising expectations of the groups of people we deal with through exposure, as you said, and true mentorship is very important. And so a lot of people here, in terms of investing in the continent, investing could also be investing of your time in terms of provided guided tutorials. There are a lot of online content that is available. You can do some guided courses, check in over Skype, and guide whole groups of young kids to become the next generation of innovators.
One thing I've observed in East Africa, where I've been a lot, is how strong the schooling system is, but how hard it is to get into a good university and pay for that university. In the US, we have the luxury, you know, one thing that allows a lot of us to go to school is we get student loans. For better or for worse, it enables a lot of people to go to school. And there's really not much of a program for student lending in Africa as a whole. Correct me if I'm wrong, if you guys observe otherwise, but that's my anecdotal observation. So I started a program where we would extend student loans to people that otherwise couldn't go to school, and we partnered with this one university called Strathmore, which is sort of like an MIT-type university in Nairobi. They admitted 200 people a year that couldn't go to school, mostly because they're from the rural area, right? And so our idea was, okay, let's just get 10% of these people a year into this program where we provide you a 0% interest 11-year student loan from people all over the world. So I was there when these students were getting their loans, and they were posted on a website, and then someone in Seattle lends them $25, and someone in Germany lends them money, and it was just amazing to see these kids and see that their whole idea of themselves expanded when they realized that there's this community of people all over the world that was going to lend them money to help them go to school, you know, and have to pay back over 11 years, really easy loan terms. And so these students now have this backing of all these people around the world to go to this world-class university. It's just really exciting. And so I was there, you know, the first cohort of students to get their loans, I was there to give them a speech and congratulate them. And I, you know, as a Mzungu or American tourist in Africa, I was getting into the African ideologies, and I was speaking about Ubuntu, saying, you know, this is like the concept of Ubuntu, a community coming together to sponsor you, to raise the community together. And I'll never forget this one woman who is Maasai from Narok, Kenya. She asked me, are you talking about the Linux operating system? So it just goes to show you how high-tech these students can be, how high-tech they are. They're studying computer science, and they're graduating ready to work, amazing developers. We're starting to employ them. But I also realized that there's not a lot of startups hiring African developers right now in that part of the world, even though it's a great opportunity. And that's probably mostly because there's not a lot of funding for startups. And so I'm able to raise money here in San Francisco to start a startup there, but there's not a lot of Africans able to raise that kind of seed capital, like $1 million just to do your crazy idea. That just is very rare in East Africa, at least where I work. And I sort of wonder why that is. And I can't really solve that problem. But if you guys might have a lot of good ideas, I think it probably has to do with the fact that there's not a lot of exits, right? So venture capitalists haven't seen a lot of exits in sub-Saharan Africa where it makes sense to put money in a startup that could be very successful because there's not a big track record of these startups being bought by either African companies or foreign companies or anyone. So I think that's what we need to start seeing in sub-Saharan Africa is more exits, more investors getting a return on their investment. Otherwise, it's just going to be foreign companies coming in and, you know, hiring people, but not the entrepreneurs from Africa being able to raise that kind of money.
And to answer the question more directly, you know, regarding how to make an innovator, you know, I think there are three things involved. As Isaiah said, you need mentors, right? And you can also see that as a community. You need a community of other makers or people who are older, more experienced than you, who can transfer their knowledge. Then you also need just the knowledge, whether it's a class or books or access to the internet where you can learn things that you don't already know. And then you need access to tools. And in the program that I ran, I think we were able to provide all three of these things. And what we observed was that, for instance, the 30 to 40% of our students that came in having never seen computers before, within 3 days, across the board, they were all writing script or code, you know. And in 5 weeks, you know, after being immersed in this engineering instruction, you can imagine that these kids were writing scripts that allowed their robots to, you know, intelligently navigate obstacle courses, taking in inputs for the environment, picking up objects, reading colors, following lines. And all these kids, prior to our program, none of them had written a line of code. And some of them hadn't seen computers. And a lot of these kids had aspirations to be things like engineers or doctors, and by the end of it, a lot of them had changed. Well, they really just broke out of their former state of mind and started to wonder what else could be out there for them, right? So is this like entire shift in the way they thought and they saw the world? And so, yeah, in 5 weeks, we created a ton of innovators, and I think that's all you need. Education, or the knowledge, the individuals, the community around you, the mentors, and access the actual tools that will allow you to innovate, to build, and to make. So.
And I just want to kind of follow up on your point a little bit, Obinna, in that I agree with you, but I also think that, you know, context is really important. And In my work in capacity development, I found that quite often if you're working in an area where there are less resources, the mentorship or the schooling or the training you provide has to be augmented by something else. Additional support, you know, I used to train people to defend their own rights in a refugee camp in Thailand, for example. And you would have people who couldn't come to class because they didn't have food, or who couldn't find people to watch their children, or whose relative was sick. And so I think, you know, I think the tools that you're talking about are super and super important. That investment is super critical. But I also think that we definitely have to keep the context in mind and keep the students that we want to attract in mind. So I just wanted to.
We've seen major raises in the African tech space, primarily focusing on the e-commerce and financial technology, expanding to renewable energy and app-based solutions. You all have described different solutions for supporting innovators, and whether that be mobile payment processing, or, you know, any ways to democratize entrepreneurship. So on that note, what Africa-focused technology solution do you advocate for most, and why?
I would say transport. I think with the growth of urban centers, there's a large degree of collaboration that occurs. And for example, why do people come to San Francisco? You might, after a week, meet someone you never thought you would ever meet. And so, this kind of dynamic doesn't even exist in a lot of American cities. But I think as transport systems improve, you have this urbanization and the high incidence of meeting people that you might be able to collaborate with. So I think the fact that sometimes the transport infrastructure is not there can lead to a lot more collaboration, because entrepreneurship doesn't happen in a bubble. Despite the media messages around Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg, they don't create the product that we use today. It's a lot of collaboration that happens. Y Combinator, you try and apply as a sole founder, you might most likely get rejected. So there's a element of collaboration that needs to happen, and trust that needs to happen among founders to actually even get funding. And so, if the transport systems are lacking and I need to take a taxi for 2 hours or 3 hours to get somewhere to build something with you for another 2 hours and then another 3 hours, most likely after a couple of weeks I'll fall away. But if the transport systems are there, I'm going to be there every day, right? And we're going to build every day. So I think transport is one of the key drivers of innovation.
I guess I can go next. For me, I think it's still going to be looking to mobile technology. And why am I saying mobile technology? I'm looking at it from the total coverage for the whole, you know, for the whole area. And I'm thinking about platforms like, you know, exchanges. You know, when you build an exchanges where maybe a farmer in a rural area would be able to actually play within those exchanges and knows what the market price of what they are selling is, you know, because they have those access, because they can access it from, you know, everybody having a smartphone now as opposed to a dumb phone. So with that, you know, if you really have an exchange, you know, where everything's within a mobile platform, then it becomes easier for all these folks in the rural areas also to be able to play in the global market, because now they, you know, they're all playing on the exchanges. They know whatever products that they are, you know, as an, you know, maybe somebody in agriculture, they know they're producing rice or something like that. They know what it should cost in the global market. So with that information, they know, you know, they will be able to buy and sell, you know, their products at the fair price. And again, another thing I also would like to say is we talk about renewable energy, and I think this could be another way where we can, you know, they can play renewable energy, because the cost of the infrastructure to actually to be able to design on and, you know, have a renewable energy infrastructure is very high. But if you have a platform where, you know, applying the same idea with mobile payment and everything, where people can actually pay to be, you know, to get energy off grid, you know, everything through their phone without having to do the initial, you know, investments, that would be another way to really, you know, impact folks in the rural area. So I still think the mobile technology is still going to be the way to go, and I just think that we're going to see a lot of other applied, other applications that will be built upon these mobile technologies that will make life easier for everybody throughout the continent.
I would love to agree with you, with Bolaji. I think mobile technologies are incredibly important, especially in terms of just data transparency. You know, I think I'm a huge supporter of any startup, any piece of software or either via phone or web that allows people to access more information. I think a great example is a company in Nigeria called Budget, like budget with an I where the E should be, which allows Nigerian citizens to access the information on the budget that's meant to be designated for their local government or state. That way, if they notice that roads aren't being built, they can go to Budget's website or their mobile application, see if there was a budget allocated to building a road in their community, and if that road isn't being built, they can, you know, pursue through the proper channels, I guess, some sort of corrective measure. And that's a huge change, and I think it's gonna help to make the environment, the entrepreneurial environment, even better, more tenable, because it reduces corruption, because corruption just becomes more difficult to do, because everything is out in the open now.
Visible.
Yeah, everything is visible. And I think any startup that's working on something like that is incredibly important. I'm not sure how lucrative it is yet, but as far as like a social value is concerned, it's incredibly fundamental. There are also startups that are helping collect data that censuses would normally collect. Right. Yeah, I mean, in Africa in general, especially in a place like Nigeria, the data blackout is very real. It's very difficult to get data on specific things just around the country. If you want to know how many people are farming a certain kind of crop, or how many families have how many, you know, kids or whatever, it's very difficult to get any sort of specific data. But there are a lot of companies, you know, through using phones and forms and all that stuff, they're collecting that data. And you know, allowing us to just know a lot more about the community that we live in, and that, you know, that helps governance, that helps businesses market their products more efficiently, develop the right products for the right cohorts of individuals, and things like that. So data and transparency, that's what I would say.
I would definitely say, and I'm not just saying this because Matt's on the panel, but I think that anything that helps people with financial inclusion, so any kind of financially related technology, I think is hugely beneficial. As I mentioned before, I worked in areas of related to international labor rights, and I also research informal markets and exclusion. And one thing that you often see is the most impoverished, most vulnerable people rarely have access to financial sort of institutions, and spend much more money on the same things that their counterparts who have access to these institutions do. So I think anything that kind of can democratize that is hugely important in terms of wealth creation and retention.
Yeah, and a really interesting trend that's happening in like the last 2 or 3 years is that for the first time, people are generating data that they get to keep. There's a lot of monopolies in emerging markets, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. You go to any one of our countries and you'll see a big telecom, big bank. And you know, when I was starting off in microfinance, the big telecoms and big banks would have all this data about their customers, but they were hoarding it, right? And you couldn't access it to make loan decisions or to do your work. And the borrowers, or the customers, didn't really have access to their own data either. The cool thing now is with smartphones, a lot of their data, a lot of an average person's data is stored on your phone. It's there, it's on the hard drive. And so if you want to prove yourself, or you can generate a reputation with your data. You can give it to a third party, an internet startup, and to prove who you are in places where there's no formal credit score, there's no portable reputation for a lot of people. It's a really empowering thing that people can have their own data and can, use it as they choose to send to the companies that they choose. And financial services are so huge as a part of this. We're going to see a complete disruption of banks. Banks are pretty bad at what they do in most of our countries. They're big, they're slow to innovate, they're not giving their customers modern financial services. So you're going to see startups completely, decompose banks, all the functions of a bank, P2P payments. You know, right now that's, you think of M-Pesa, Airtel doing P2P payments, but it's going to be like a Venmo for Africa. It's going to be a startup that really breaks open payments cross-border, cross-platform, cross-telecom. insurance. There's going to be a whole wave of insurance startups that provide great insurance to customers, much better than big insurance can offer. There's going to be deposits and investing companies. So if any of you want to start a startup like that, I think it's just an amazing time. Not because of M-Pesa necessarily, not because of telecoms offering mobile payments necessarily, but because of the smartphone and the fact that users can access companies and startups directly despite the large monopolies with which they have to interact.
Mike, if you, can I pose a question to you?
Sure, thanks.
There's
interactive. We should be talking to each other.
Awesome.
Yeah.
There's a high growth startup in Lagos known as Pagatech, founded by a Stanford GSB alum, and they had to transition from a mobile platform to a data or web platform because MTN and all the other carriers, they basically, and the banks, they blocked off access, right? So you know, you start this company that's doing mobile payments. A bank says, "Oh, that's lucrative." They basically shut down your escrow account, start their own mobile payment system. A mobile network notices that you're using their lines to do it. They block you out, start their own mobile payment. So like, how do you?
That's the scary future for which I'm not prepared.
Okay.
So you just described the scary future from which I'm running.
Okay.
So well, let's hope that doesn't happen to me. It could happen, right? Then that's probably what keeps entrepreneurs out, is these big oligarchies, I don't know if that's the word, monopolies owned by a few people have the ability to bully innovation out of their country, which can be very difficult. So Android is a hedge against that because it makes it harder because, like I said, users have their data. They can share it across different telecoms, and the telecom can't keep it. But certainly, for instance, where I work right now in Kenya, I have one country risk. If the big telecom there, Safaricom, wants to block me, they just could. And I couldn't really do anything about it. So I think it's a really good point.
I'd like to add that it's not really unique to these countries. So so Facebook is in the emerging markets. They created an organization called Internet.org.
Yeah.
They basically said, you connect through Internet.org, and we're going to expose you to a limited subset of the Internet, including Facebook.
Sure.
And there was a backlash in India regarding that and the carriers that signed on to that. So I think to get around stuff like that, you need to build engagement with the users so that that's an added value. So when a competitor comes with a competitive product, it's not a product versus a product. It's a whole engagement and a whole ecosystem that they're tied into with a reputation system as well. Mm. And then the users push back against the incumbents. Because I mean, they protect market share. That's what they do. Microsoft got sued, antitrust. That's what companies do.
That's what companies do.
So as an innovator, you need to figure out the system in which you operate and how to get around this particular system.
So what's your best advice for me? I think it's build a great brand that's loved by engaging its customers.
I'll give you my card after.
Yeah.
just kidding.
I need therapy. How am I gonna?
It comes down to what is innovation, right? Is innovation building a product? Is it building a process, right? If you, and what I see a lot is companies going into Africa and imposing technology as a solution, as opposed to technology as a vehicle, right? You have micro financing, which in my country is a traditional Yoruba custom, susu, no interest loans among people. You see Uber and carpooling, which is a concept exists in developing countries, right?
Except you pay.
Right?
You pay your friends.
You're right? So what is happening is technology needs to be used as a vehicle to enhance the existing cultures and behavior of the particular society, as opposed to saying, these are the technologies and this is what you should do, right? And so I've been having conversations with my network of nieces and friends and stuff, and they're coming up with stuff that suits the behaviors of that particular society using the technology, right? So a lot of times, if it is that we are looking to support countries who are breaking into emerging markets, what is going to happen in 10 years is that these people are going to figure out that technology is just a means, and just as Facebook had Facebook Messenger, but wasn't able to replicate WhatsApp and had to acquire them, the developing countries are going to develop technologies that is going to drive technology in the developed countries.
But do you see, because I agree with your point, the problem that I see is I have no local Kenyan competitor. Mm-hmm. My competitors are Americans, actually, who are doing the same things. Because even though the Kenyans might know their culture and what be able to build a better product than us Americans, they simply don't have the startup ecosystem, and no one gave them $1 million to start a company.
Well, it's you don't even need $1 million anymore, right?
Do you have a lot of examples of, you know, organically created, locally created solutions that scaled in your countries that were, despite getting financing or not?
Yeah.
What I'm seeing in Nairobi right now is just there, and last time I was there, I took taxis. This time I'm taking Uber. Uber is taking off all across Kenya.
And on the flip side, there's Uber for China, where the Chinese imitate Uber, and they're all taking the equivalent.
But why didn't people in Uganda create their own version of Uber? Yeah. Why is Uber, the actual Uber, taking over East Africa?
There's one other factor that we haven't put into this, which is really the government and the policy. Mm-hmm. You know, I think we're talking about China because, you know, they were able to do that in China because they have the policy in place to kind of make it happen for them.
Yeah.
But within a lot of these African countries, first of all, we don't have the necessary expertise right there, even within the government, to really understand what is going on. So what needs to happen is for, you know, Google to come in and give them $1 million, you know, $1 billion. They will sign anything they want them to sign. You know, so I think that's why it's a little bit difficult to be able to do that kind of a thing within the continent. But I still believe that with the kind of growth that we're seeing right now, people are beginning to see, especially people that used to be here and moved back and starting companies, they're beginning to say that, you know, we need to create a level playing field for all of us. And you know, but the only thing that also needs to be done is we need to make sure that the governments are engaged in this, because we need to let them understand why they need to take the right to make the right policy to really, you know, foster this growth within the continent.
I think, Balaji, great point. And you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I know Nigeria has really tried to ensure that any foreign entities coming into the country had significant Nigerian ownership. For instance, when McKinsey came in, I think, and that was maybe 5 years ago, they required that at least 50% of the shares were owned by Nigerians. And I think Hakim Bello Asagi was the one who brought them in eventually. And to answer your question about examples of local competitors, I think Nigeria is a bit different because it's the largest economy. That's huge, and we have some of the best entrepreneurs, if I will humbly say. So, you know, to the Uber question, we have Jekalo, which it's a carpooling thing founded by Nigerians. For Amazon hasn't entered, I don't know if they've entered Africa at all, but you have Konga, which was founded by a guy named Sim Segaye, a Nigerian guy. I would just say that Nigeria has a more vibrant economy.
Just the sheer size makes it more lucrative to have a startup?
Perhaps, and just to answer, maybe this can be like an anecdote, but there's a company called Hotels.ng, which is kind of like Expedia, which allows you to book hotels, has a database of hotels across the country. They started roughly 3 years ago or 4 years ago with about $50,000 in seed capital. They very recently received a lot of press because they raised a $1 million seed round. I do think it was from abroad. But last year, Lagos launched the Aban, right? Angel Business, the African Business Angel Network. And there are VC firms that have been launched. There's one that's launching out of San Francisco, actually, called Draper Darkflow, which is focused on Africa. So I think increasingly, maybe over the next 5 years, I think in 5 years, it's not going to be an issue anymore. I strongly believe that, at least not in Nigeria.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And I just want to jump in since we're talking about the global economic perspective and why companies are able to have more traction in some markets and innovation happens in others. I think, you know, obviously it doesn't happen in the bubble, as everybody's kind of alluded to. I think that, you know, as we were saying, the economic power that certain country has is also important. That's why the Nigeria case holds. That's why the China case holds. It's because they're able to leverage their economic power and perhaps don't necessarily need to take advantage or readily accept outside actors coming in and the investment terms that those outside actors have once they get into the country. So I just wanted to kind of add that little.
Good point.
What about the role of the?
Hey, let me ask a question.
We're gonna talk all night.
Hey, come on, guys.
All right.
Okay, well, we are running out of time, and I have 1.5 questions left. I'll start with the first one. Why Vaughn? This is for you. We've been touching a lot on democratizing access and touching on human rights here and there.
Wow.
This one's for you.
Okay. A little one.
What can technology do to protect human rights?
Okay, so I definitely have thought a little bit about this. You know, I think I want to take a step back and just say there that, you know, with technological innovation, there's just as much of a danger to exacerbate the sort of divisions that you see in society as to solve problems and address them. So I think that you have to, and you have to be very careful about the people that you want to reach, you know, with your technology. And I think when we talk about entrepreneurship and innovation and how we do that, I think it's really important to keep in mind that we just don't want to reinforce the same power struggles that exist in a country or the same economic dichotomies that are in place. We don't want to just access the existing middle class that might already have a computer at home or knows what schools they want to go to or already has access to university. So I think outreach is really important. I think holistic interventions are really important. I think when those things happen, I think that economic development has been tied to that. You know, you've seen it in some of the Asian countries, and I think that can happen just as easily in Africa. I think if you want to talk about the potential on the human rights scale for technology, I think that there are already some great examples that have been cited today. The mHealth space is huge, and sort of improving access to care, improving lifespans, reducing maternal mortality, those are all great things that are being done by African entrepreneurs as well. I think things like access to food, so you look at some of the amazing investments that are happening in the agricultural space and amazing technologies that are coming out of there, that's super exciting. You look at voting technologies and recent elections and tracking and increasing accountability, and those are all great. So I think that was a huge question. and there's a lot of potential, both on the individual level and on the societal level, but I think that we can't look at technology as a panacea, kind of like what you were saying. I think it's a vehicle, and we have to deploy that vehicle responsibly. So.
And the issues around personal identifiable information, the regulatory structure here in the U.S. is kind of a little advanced, but in a lot of other countries, it doesn't really exist. And so how do you protect the identities of people and their usage, data usage, the data you collect on them? From knowing who they are to knowing their behavioral patterns and knowing the network that they're connected to, how often, when, why. There's potential for abuse, both from the people collecting the data and the people who have probably politicians and political entities who have access to that data. We know that the last election, big data was actually used to increase the velocity of the candidate who won. And for this coming election in the U.S. here, you're going to see a lot more use of big data and the ability to collect massive data at scale, including sending messaging and seeing the sentiment in real time, what messages work, what messages don't work. So there's a potential for abuse that exists as well, as well as a good social impact. So it's just something that governments and people on the whole need to kind of understand the landscape.
Okay, last question, really quick. Everyone, so if you could leave the audience with one last note, one last message, 5 sentences or less, on the new generation of African innovators, what would that message be? Is that big? Should I get a little more specific?
Five sentences. I heard the word. It's really tripping out there.
Or an anecdote. Okay. Short. Somebody else? Anyone?
Okay.
Go ahead.
I would say that if there are any, if there's anyone in the audience looking to invest, there are a lot of amazing investment opportunities, and the bar is really low just because of the purchasing power parity, right? 50 grand is a pretty sizable seed round for somebody working on a startup in Lagos, compared to like $500,000 here in the Bay Area. And I would say that while Africa does have a lot of work to do in terms of creating investable innovators, there are a lot of diamonds in the rough, and then there are a lot of very investable, very competent innovators out there. You know, you owe yourself a trip if you haven't been down to meet some of them in person. But yeah, awesome things are happening, and you wouldn't want to miss out on it, because a decade from now, it's going to be a very different continent. So,
I think I'll actually add to that, you know, I think I know actually that there are really a lot of smart, energetic entrepreneurs out there. There are a lot of guys doing interesting things that, you know, when they show you to people, like, wow. But at the same time, I think when you look at them, you also want to take into consideration the fact that a lot of these guys are smart. They know what they're doing, but they may not be as polished as people that you're used to over here, you know, when they pitch the ideas to you. So you want to kind of go beyond, you know, the way they pitch it, you know, to more of what the content of what they're talking about, you know, and if you do that, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, money and influence to make back there. Just overlook the way they look and the way they're pitching.
I'll go ahead. Can I go ahead and take one?
Oh, sorry.
I was just gonna say my tip would be both for investors and entrepreneurs, and that is nobody knows your market like you do. And I think now is such a great time, and there, like everybody has alluded to, there are so many people, so many energetic entrepreneurs that know their market, and their market just happens to be the fastest growing market, you know? So I think that, that now's a great time, and the knowledge is there, the most important knowledge is there.
I would just say, you know, I've been talking about investing in African small business for 10 years now, and mostly from a social angle. I would say in the last 2 or 3 years, it's the first time where I can actually say, personally, from a purely economic standpoint, things are changing, and this is a really different time in the last 2 to 3 years. And we have this, as you were referring to, we have this window of time where the rest of the world doesn't fully realize that. And a lot of us in this room have unique connections to Africa and the economies there. And so we're in an amazing arbitrage opportunity because we know something that's happening that the average person walking around San Francisco doesn't know is quite happening. It's urbanization, rise of the middle class, rise of the internet and the smartphone are absolutely transforming the economies. And it's going to be a lot different in 10 years. The pace of change is just going to pick up. It's going to be amazing. It's a lot more interesting to me than in starting a startup in, you know, the US, for instance, where most of the fields that we enter are saturated and highly competitive. There's just so many low-hanging fruit in any one of the countries we've discussed today to start a really profitable business, but also one you can feel good about because you're providing services to people who really are using it for the first time and are really, really thankful.
Yeah, I'd like to say that I'm looking at not the top 10 fastest growing economies in Africa, but the second 10, because the cost of technology is like very low, and the innovations that's happening right now, like software-defined networks, right? Network virtualization, cloud computing, will mean that previously where we had to supply people with computers, now we just need to connect them with a browser and to spin up a computer in the cloud, right? And what's going to happen is that second tier of countries is going to leapfrog the first tier, just as the top 10 leapfrogged the landline-connected countries who were ahead, and they had mobile-first solutions. So I think cloud computing, software-defined networks, network virtualization, the stuff that we in the U.S. are trying to do, is going to be done for these countries without infrastructure, and they're actually going to be the next wave that would leapfrog even the current wave. So I think the investment opportunities, they're huge, and I'm just happy to be here. See it.
Thank you. Yeah. Have one thing to say?
I have one question to ask you guys. I don't mean to be controversial. And before I ask my question, you know, I have deep respect for Matt. I like what you're doing. So my question is, so let's assume I have money. I'm taking a tour of tech in Africa. I don't really want to, it's going to be a feel-good environment, but I don't really want to feel good. I want to make money. So my question to you, everybody in the panel, is can you point to one startup in Africa that you will invest in if you go on the tour? And I want to emphasize that this is not a feel-good thing. My frame of reference is I can go to YC and invest in something and make money, and I want to make money. So the question is, and I'm taking notes, right? So this is serious, like one startup in Africa that you think I can put in money today and I'll make money, name and why.
Interesting.
I thought he was going to attack me. Anytime someone starts off a comment with, I respect you, that's...
So I talked about, I think we talk about e-commerce and, there's quite a few players. For example, in Nigeria, when we get to Nigeria, we talk about Jumia and Conga and what they're doing. I'm actually looking, I will look beyond that. I look at what others may, when I look at a business model, what others may consider as maybe a next tier to those guys. There's a company called More for Africa. What they do is they play in the same e-commerce, but they don't really keep a lot of inventory like Jumia and Conga we do. But they still facilitate people being able to do their transactions and buy whatever they need to get anywhere around the world and have them deliver to them there in Nigeria. So I see them having huge opportunity to growth, and it's a locally grown. It's an organic grown company. They didn't have any. I mean, it was started by two Nigerians, two brothers. So I see the kind of things they've been doing, and I would might put money on that.
So I'm only familiar with East Africa, but there's a lot of startups working in the financial services space, which are really amazing, especially in the off-grid solar space. I mean, you might be familiar, but sort of the last two or three years have seen this incredible boom in off-grid solar, sort of SIM-enabled systems. Just the growth rates are ridiculous. So maybe it's a little late to invest in them because they've already had their Series A. But if I could go back a year ago, I would have invested. So like in Kenya, there's M-Kopa. In Tanzania, there's a startup called Off-Grid Electric. And most of the countries we're from in this room, there's a version of that where people are essentially franchise lending an asset, a solar panel for your house, and then the users of it pay it back over time. And the lender can essentially turn it off remotely if the user doesn't repay. And the user almost always repays for that reason. And there's already in a couple of years like 300,000 of these in Kenya already. And the same thing's happened in Tanzania. So that's where I would invest. I would also invest in my company because it's just growing ridiculous. There's a company called Inventure, which is sort of a very similar company to mine, which is growing ridiculous. There's CopoCopo, which is growing. There's this company called Echo. All these are like financial services startups in East Africa. Zuna in Zambia. There's some mobile payments startups, mobile financial services startups. My friend started a company called Socotra, which is providing insurance from the cloud, which just got to raise a ton of money too. So, but I would say that the companies I would really invest in haven't started yet, so you should start them. That's what I would do.
And I'd actually like to comment on that. Through Ingressive, I mean, the concentration of what we do is sourcing sub-Saharan-based tech companies. And I would say, OK Hi, which you probably know out of East Africa, out of Kenya, Hello Tractor, Bionic, and Tomato Joe's out of Nigeria.
What are those?
OK Hi is solving the issue of GPS navigation. So they're a physical GPS navigation company solving the issue for 4 billion people around the world. And Hello Tractor is a two-wheel, affordable, it's about $3,000 rural tractor company that also provides a mobile platform, so rural African farmers can rent the tractor, and it cuts the harvesting time down by like 400%. Tomato Joss is solving the problem of inefficient logistics relative to bringing produce, specifically tomato paste, from rural Africa to inner cities. Bionic is mobile payment processing out of Kenya. But a lot of these solutions that we're talking about, we're always focused on who would spend, you know, $5,000 a day or a month or, you know, a year on this product. But what we really have to focus on is looking at these looking at these economies and these markets that maybe would spend $1 a week or $1 a year, but can seriously hit scale. 4 billion people spending $1 a week is a lot of money. Mm. So yeah.
One thing I wonder though is if we invested in all these companies, what would the exits be? That's what I can't wrap my mind around. So you can readily predict that the majority of these that we just described will grow and make money. What's difficult is to imagine how, as an investor, you make money. And I just don't, I'm not an investor, I don't understand things like that, but will they sell to somebody? Is Google going to buy, you know?
Yeah, I think a lot of it could come through acquisitions, right? Mm-hmm. Just as, hey.
I don't see that, though.
I think we will probably know in a couple of years, because there have been quite a few investments in the past couple of years, and we see, you know, what kind of, I think you're right, the exit strategy is really not there, right? I mean, the capital market is not as well, you know, defined or designed as it is over here, but with the very first, you know, couple of group of people, I mean, private equities and all that invested, I think people are kind of waiting on to see what is going to happen.
Okay, one question.
All right, great. Thanks, guys. Thanks for the organizers. What I like about this event is that you have human right part of, you know, the equation. And my question to you guys is that should I just ignore human rights like the Chinese government? Or, what is the standard there? You know, just to me, this is so personal. You know, a lot of people are dying. A lot of people are in prison. A lot of people are affected by this. But it just, I don't understand what the leaders think, but yeah, sorry.
Can I just go ahead and take that? I just really feel like it's in my wheelhouse. you have a tough decision to make. You know, if you go back and you want to affect change, and you want to do so not only without without opposing the government or without, you know. The chances are, if you're good at what you do, you're going to be influenced by the government, or you're going to be working with the government. And I think that people in your situation have to be really careful about who they choose to work with. I think also in Ethiopia, there have been some organizations that in the past could be viewed as being more neutral that have gotten kicked out, and that's something to be aware of. I think that once you slide down the government rabbit hole, it's really hard to get out of. Once they know who you are and what you're doing and they have a vested interest in your projects, it's a lot harder for you to not do those things with them. So I would just say, you know, I'm also very skeptical of certain NGOs, international NGOs, but I would say really think about carefully who you want to work with and choose carefully. And I would also suggest that you talk to the folks at EFF who are doing some work down there, and who've worked with some activists here who are from Ethiopia and are working on some cases with them, because they might be able to give you more insight into the rights climate that's there right now. So that would be my suggestion.
I have a suggestion. Okay, I really do have a suggestion. What I've found, a lot of the corruption is rooted in human-to-human interaction. You know, one person viewing a ballot, or one person, handling money, passing it over to another person. So this technological innovation across Africa is going to streamline, this ability to streamline a lot of these processes will end a lot of the corruption as we see it. So mobile payment processing, well, you can't just pay, a government official can't pay, a third-party contractor with a bag of cash anymore. You can actually track the transaction and know how much money is coming in and how much money is leaving. So there are a lot of other examples. So means by which people can use technology to access, and also going to market. If you're an e-commerce platform and you're selling a good, the government doesn't really have access to your, PayPal account or wherever the funds are coming in from your customers. So yeah, using technology to create efficiency.
Yeah, I also think, though, to a certain extent, technology creates exposure. So you look at countries like China, and even, I mentioned EFF, there was a case here where they used spying technology to spy on one of their citizens in the United States, and then that person was prosecuted, or they came after that person based on their activities in the U.S. So I think you have to be really careful about your exposure, and that's why I say, choose the way you want to interact. Think it through before you do so, because once you're out there, you're out there. And it's really hard to take that back. And so depending on the kind of activity in which you engage, depending on your thoughts about the government and the opinions you want to express, that you feel comfortable expressing over technological platforms, like that can affect your risk. So I would just want to put that in there as well.
That exists here also, but I'll stop right there.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right.
Okay.
I just want to say you seemed really personally moved by your question, or it's coming from a deeply personal place, and it's obviously an issue you really care about, and I just felt that when you were talking, and I just want to encourage you to, go for it. Whatever is coming out, that you care about, and just encourage you to take a risk and just go for it. Seems really heartfelt.
Mm-hmm. I have a quick question, and it's about, I feel like a lot of times when people talk about innovation, they talk about it in the sense of a startup or in your organization.
Is there no way to innovate within existing organizations, and is that a bad thing? I say this as somebody who has worked for two large banks, and so I am clearly biased, but I do think that a lot of innovation could come from existing organizations by way of partnerships or acquisitions, but I haven't heard much of that in this conversation, so I wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I'll say my niece is particularly working on partnering with a lot of enterprises, and even in my day job, we partner with a lot of startups because we can't solve our problem because we're not agile enough. To get a decision made takes 3 months, and so we work with startups and then help guide the roadmap to solve our own problems. So that is innovation as well. And that comes with exposure to other enterprises. So sometimes, as an entrepreneur, you might not know the domain space, but you have enterprises come in and say, hey, you know technology, and could you partner with us to help us solve this particular problem? And that works as well.
I definitely believe that, you can have innovation anywhere. I think the main reason we kind of focus on the startup that you actually see more on the startup side is because within a large enterprise, they have so many other projects going on. They have so many other things going on. And they'd rather just invest a certain amount and let somebody else, go do this and bring it back. From your question, yes, the innovation can happen wherever you are. It depends on what you really want to do and what kind of influence you want to have. But if it's something from your perspective that you feel like you really want to, you want to do it on your own, you want to, it's something that you want it to be your own baby sort of things, then, you branch out to do it. But it doesn't mean that you can't do it within the existing system.
And we're talking about startups here because we're in San Francisco and startups are all the rage, right? But, big organizations get a lot more done in general than startups do. The reason I work in startups is because I was unable to work in big organizations. And I wouldn't wish that on anyone that could operate in a large organization. I just couldn't keep a job. So that's the only reason I took this hard path.
On that note. Okay, is it something that you can ask? Is it so pressing that it must be asked to the group, or can you come up and ask individuals? Okay, one more question, and then we're done, and then everyone can have wine, because it's still there, and there are a lot of bottles, so last question.
So I primarily work in the security field, and whenever I hear about startups and mobile transaction processing, I get excited because you guys keep me in business. So from the question I have is, as Africa starts to develop these startups, and I also look at it from a government perspective because I've worked with governments doing security also, and the ability to control traffic and the access to said services, to me, is another area that I don't think that gets discussed. In terms of transparency, there's one thing in terms of developing a service, but having your countrymen and women to actually use the service in the fashion that you want them to use it on your product is something that can be monitored, can be siphoned, can be audited, can be controlled. The notion that, it's quote unquote secure, to me is misleading to some, because if a country really, really wants to get in the middle of your transactions, they will get in the middle of your transaction, especially if there are agreements with the service providers in the country to control how traffic is routed, then most definitely that your transactions couldn't be subject to inspection. So from that standpoint, I implore everyone to continue doing startups. I love the idea, but from a security mindset, I always say that your one big breach or one misgiving to basically losing all your goods to the public. And from that perspective, I always ask, I'm always pessimistic with regards to startups and how people are interfacing with their technologies and their consumers and their customers locally in the country. So I'm interested in seeing how, if you guys have any thoughts on just the security realm of startups in relation to the governments, in relation to the transport and access that was talked about earlier.
I live that every day. Can't comment too much, but same thing happens here. Mm-hmm. All right, so
it's worse.
And I would actually add that we don't even know how big our vulnerabilities are here. I think we're still learning. So yes, and yes.
I think there's going to be this day where everyone's private data will be exposed to everyone.
It's all over.
It's just going to happen. Everyone's going to know everything about everyone. It'll happen. It's some apocalypse waiting to happen.
Is that the same time when we can read each other's minds through Google Glass? No. Or
I think your point is great. Nothing's secure. Nothing. Yeah. Nothing. Yeah. I'm doing is secure. Yeah. I'm one breach away from complete disaster. Yeah. And worries me a lot.
Okay. Well, thank you guys. Thank everyone for coming.